Well, when I was in middle school, I participated in the Rainbow Iron Kids Triathlon. This is a short swim, a short bike ride, and a short run. And it happened in Wichita. My sister and I participated every year, several years in a row. We'd arrive on site at 4:30 in the morning. We would get our bikes into transition. You get your name, your number written on your arm. You pin your race bib. Thank you. Don't know why that word was failing me, but you race bib on and you get ready to go. The event starts at 7 o'clock, and the awards ceremony was around 11. And the first thing they did at the awards ceremony was we all got to go up and get a loaf of bread because every year it was on Mother's Day. My mother used to say, "What a great Mother's Day gift. I get to get up at 4 a.m., stand around for 7 hours, and get a loaf of bread." The motto of the event was, "Every finisher is a winner." And I remember thinking, okay, that's fine. I agree with that. I mean, except for my age group, right? There could only be one winner in my age group. As we look to the upcoming Olympic events, we know that only one winner will emerge from the competitions. These are the best of the best. But George Steinbrenner, the owner of the New York Yankees, says that the only thing that matters is winning. Is that really the most important thing? I mean, I question it a little bit because every morning we will see the updates of the medal counts. Which country has the most medals, right? Which country has the most gold medals? We're a competitive people, and there is an element of that that's probably an okay and good thing. But the problem is when that competition spills over into ways that are destructive. Our faith should never be a competition. The way we put good into the world should not be a competition. Keeping up with our neighbors should not be a competition. If we were going to suggest other values beyond standing on the top of the podium and winning, hearing our national anthem, what might those values be? Teamwork? Global connection? Maybe we should consider, how do we find perseverance when we feel exhausted? How do we move beyond the stitch in our side? How do we find that second wind to kick into the finish? Paul is writing not just to anyone. Paul is writing to his dearest friend, Timothy. This third generation Christian following in his mother and his grandmother's footsteps. Timothy, who's Paul's most devoted and loyal companion on his missional journeys. Paul trusts Timothy so much that he makes him the bishop of the church in Ephesus. Timothy will lead Ephesus forward. As Paul is writing, though, he is in prison, and he knows that his death is imminent because the governor Nero is about to have him executed by beheading. And so he writes this letter to encourage Timothy to be steadfast in his faith, even when it is a difficult time. Paul has traveled throughout the known world, all through the Roman Empire, Asia Minor, the Arabian Desert. He's witnessed about Christ. He's preached to thousands of people. He's begun numerous communities. He's been run out of towns, beaten, arrested. He's seen the worst and the best of humanity. But his race, Paul's race, is almost over. And he wants to pass on to the next generation the torch. "You take over," Paul writes. I'm done. All that's left now is the applause. See, Paul hears a cheering squad. He can hear others ensuring that that baton gets passed to someone else. Paul isn't concerned with winning, he's concerned with enduring, that the church will endure, that leadership will endure, that grace will endure. These are the things that matter to Paul. Historians will tell us that in 490 BC, a Greek messenger by the name of Pheidippides was dispatched by a Greek general to inform the citizens of Athens that the Persians had been defeated at the Battle of Marathon. Pheidippides ran a route that took him south along the coast and then over the foothills before descending into Athens, which was an exact distance of 26 miles from the plains of Marathon. According to legend, Pheidippides arrived into Athens. He announced, "Rejoice, we conquer," and then he fell down dead. The ancient Olympic Games paid honor to Pheidippides by having these long-distance races that were run. Paul would have been familiar with the Olympic Games, but it was actually the modern Games, started in 1896, which initiated the modern marathon of 26.2 miles to honor dear old Pheidippides. In 1971, there's a story about the runner Frank Shorter. And he was at mile 21, and he was really struggling. He had hit that wall. And as he was being passed by U.S. Olympian Kenny Moore, Shorter groaned one of the most famous lines in running lore, "Why couldn't Pheidippides have died at mile 21? Whether we're running a marathon, we're training for a triathlon, or dare I say, we're just living life, we must learn the skills of perseverance and stamina and finding hope when the well is dry. Whether it's a competition or your personal life, we have to find that second wind, to find how we move beyond the wall. We live in a society that tells us winning is the ultimate goal, but it isn't. And if anyone learned that truth, it was Muhammad Ali, the self-proclaimed greatest boxer of all time, the 1960 gold medalist. His fight outside the sport would show us what it means to actually compete in life, to stand up against racism and discrimination and eventually Parkinson's disease. Do you remember the 1996 Olympics in Atlanta? Do you remember him lighting that cauldron? My 17-year-old self remembers that we didn't know who was going to light it. We weren't told. We didn't even know. And then you see Muhammad Ali, and we knew immediately who it was. But the world was shocked to find how much Parkinson's had changed his life, the grip it had on him. And yet, do you remember the roar of thousands cheering him on to hold that torch high and then to dip down and light it, the light that would be carried up to the cauldron? He is passing on the Olympic spirit. That's something more than winning. It's something more than gold. It's being part of a global village. It is persevering through our challenges. It means so much to have people cheering you on. I don't know if you remember the Olympics from just 3 years ago, but a unique thing happened. There wasn't hardly anyone in the stands, because it was COVID, and the athletes had to just imagine their families cheering them on. I want you to imagine that this is a stadium full of people who are watching you run the race of life. Who's in the stands there? Who's cheering you on? Who's encouraging you? I imagine for me, one of the people is Wanda Groves. Wanda was at every single Iron Kids triathlon cheering us on. I sang with her husband, Jim, in the church choir. This is a picture of her just before her 82nd birthday when she biked across Kansas. A week before her death at 98, she was biking 4 miles a day. Wanda Groves was always cheering people on in the race of life. Now, I want you to imagine you're back in that stadium, but instead of running the marathon, you're running the relay. And now it's time for you to pass that baton on. How good are you at giving the baton to the next generation? Will you slip? Are you better than the U.S. men's team recently? Nope, not quite. There it is. It is not enough to want to pass the baton. You have to be ready to shove it into the hand of the person you are passing it on to. Who are the people in your life that you're passing that baton on towards? Who are the people in life? Who are your Timothys? Whose stadium are you in cheering them on to fight in the midst of the struggles of their life? I like to imagine that in our stadiums are our saints, whoever those saints are. But I like to also imagine that Paul the Apostle is in our stadium as well. Just as Timothy stood by his side, he stands by our side. So may we be as faithful as Paul, willing to pass the baton on and cheer others on to the goal. And may we know that the race is not over. We still have running to do. Amen. Amen.